Welcome to my classroom. We are in this session visiting the renewal theory, which is one of the major theories in failure work. It concerns situations where repair work leads to the renewal of units, mostly components. We start by shortly revisiting the available maintenance strategy options. Enjoy. Traditionally, it was assumed that both scheduled reconditioning and scheduled replacement leaves the item in the as good as new condition after use-based preventive action. A theory called renewal theory developed around this premise. In other words, the renewal theory is the theory that explains failure situations where use-based preventive actions lead to complete restoration. This theory can be approached from different angles using different mathematical theory bases. Often it is approached from the side of statistical distributions. It is generally accepted that failures, where the renewal assumption holds, take place according to some or other distribution. The one that is used most often in maintenance work is the Weibull distribution, named after the author of the distribution. It is a very versatile distribution that can simulate most failure situations found in maintenance practice. The four reliability functions were introduced previously. These were the density function, the cumulative distribution function, the survival function, and the force of mortality. They form the basis of stochastic renewal theory and will now be defined more clearly. We start with the detailed definitions. Firstly, the density function. A typical failure situation consists of a population of n components of which not necessarily all have failed yet. This population includes all present incumbents of components of that type fitted in holes, that is, places where they are installed, in the present fleet of machines, as well as all those fitted in the past of which life history was kept. Just by way of a note, a hole is a position on a machine in which a component can be fitted. When a component occupying that hole fails, it is removed and replaced with an identical component, or the old component is restored or reconditioned. The importance of the concept of a hole lies in the fact that if the hole is undamaged, replacement or reconditioning leads to complete restoration, which is renewal. The probability density function is then defined as the probability that the time of failure T star will be the same as the present time T. The probability density function gives the probability of failure occurring at a specific time. Its units are failure per item time. Thus, at any point, it gives the probability of a failure occurring during the following time unit. The figure which shows a typical probability density function was already shown in our discussion of the quantitative descriptions of failure and is repeated here for convenience sake. Second, then, the cumulative distribution function. The cumulative distribution function, capital F of T, is defined as the cumulative probability that failure will take place before or at time t. In other words, it is the probability that the time of failure, t star, will fall within the interval 0 to t. This is calculated through cumulatively summing up the area under the density function as shown in the figure. For completeness sake, we can then show the relationship as we did before in our discussion of the quantitative descriptions of failure. This figure illustrates the principle. The scales are different to our main graphs used in the video, but the principle holds. The cumulative failure distribution function corresponding to our main density function, which was already shown in our discussion of the quantitative descriptions of failure, is again repeated here. This function gives the cumulative probability of failure. It thus represents the probability that failure has occurred on or before a certain time. It also states that all components will eventually fail, That is f of infinity equals 1. Number 3, the survival function. The survival function RT is defined as the probability that failure will take place after time t. In other words, it is the probability that the time of failure, t star, will fall within the interval t to infinity. The survival or reliability function is thus the complement of the failure distribution function. It gives the probability of survival up to any specific time t. For completeness sake, we again show the relationship as we did before in our discussion of the quantitative descriptions of failure. This figure illustrates the principle. The scales are different to our main graphs used in this video, but the principle holds. The survival function corresponding to our cumulative distribution function, which was already shown in our discussion of quantitative descriptions, is again repeated here. It still states that all components are still operative when new, that is, that R at time 0 equals 1, and will eventually fail, that is, R at time infinity equals 0. Number 4, the hazard function. Certainly the most important function in the renewal theory is the hazard function, or the force of mortality. The shape of this function to a large extent determines what maintenance strategy will be used to maintain a specific component. The hazard function is defined as the probability that the time of failure t star will fall in the next instant, that is between t and t plus dt, given that it has not yet failed. The hazard function or force of mortality corresponding to our other three previous functions, which was already shown in our discussion of the quantitative descriptions of failure, is again repeated here. As was discussed earlier in our discussion of the quantitative descriptions of failure, the hazard function or the force of mortality gives the risk of failure at any specific time, given that it has not failed up to that time. It is thus the conditional probability of failure at that time, as is evident from equation 4.4. We have already discussed the various shapes of the hazard function in our discussion of the quantitative descriptions of failure. Refer to chapter 3 of the textbook. Pages 83 and 84 of the textbook gives a detailed derivation of the following equation from the definitions given in equations 4.1 to 4.4. The result is given in equation 4.5, which greatly simplifies the calculation of the hazard function. Our next topic discusses the Weibull distribution, which is used in handling the renewal theory numerically. The Weibull distribution was the result when Weibull in 1951 suggested an empirical formula that could handle most real-life failure data. The Weibull distribution is a distribution that was developed specifically for use in failure work. It is a very versatile distribution, which can be used for most maintenance renewal problems. Most important for our purpose is the fact that it can handle all the more frequently encountered shapes of the force of mortality, including those of the exponential and the normal distributions. This leads to the possibility of using only this one distribution for most practical failure analysis applications. There are two main manifestations of the Weibull distribution, a two-parameter version and a three-parameter version. We will only cover the two-parameter version in this video, in the interest of limiting the learning required. The three-parameter version is available in the textbook on pages 87 and 88. First, then, the two-parameter Weibull distribution itself. The two-parameter Weibull distribution has, as its name intimates, two parameters, which are beta and eta. The first parameter, beta, is the shape parameter. And the second, eta, the scale parameter, or the characteristic life. The shape of the distribution and its derivatives thus depends on beta, and the time scale depends on eta. The typical life that one would expect from such a component based on the past history is then eta. The viable distribution is used by estimating values for its parameters such that the resultant distribution closely resembles the distribution of time to failure found in the original data. This equation represents the density function. From this, the other three functions, that's the cumulative distribution, the survival, and the hazard function, can be derived. The following figure shows the variation in shape of the various functions for different values of beta. The graphs were constructed for a value of eta equals 1. So for in all cases, eta equals 1 and beta varies for the various graphs. The special case of beta equals 1 simulates the exponential distribution. That is, the hazard or force of mortality is constant. While for t in the order of 3.5, the viable distribution simulates the normal distribution. That is, the hazard or force of mortality is strongly increasing. As can be seen from the hazard and force mortality graphs, which is the one at the bottom right, beta smaller than 1 results in a decreasing hazard or force of mortality. Beta equals 1 is in a constant hazard or force of mortality. That's the exponential case. And where beta is between 1 and 2, it results in a convex increasing hazard or force of mortality. Beta equals 2 results in a hazard force of mortality that rises in proportion to use. And beta larger than 2 in a concave, strongly increasing hazard or force of mortality. These values are extremely important as they directly affect, if not determine, the maintenance strategy for the component. In the cases where the hazard is decreasing or constant with age, that is where beta is smaller than 1 and beta equals 1, use-based prevention cannot be used. Why not? Because the hazard will be higher after such maintenance action. On the other hand, use-based maintenance is a very valid option in cases where the hazard increases with age, that is where beta is larger than 1, because the risk of failure will be lower after the intervention than before it. However, the use of use-based prevention in such cases will still depend on the economics involved. The sharper the increase in the hazard with age, the more viable use-based prevention becomes. Condition-based prevention is, of course, an option in all cases. Its viability not depending so much on the shape of the hazard, but on the physical characteristics of the component's interaction with its environment. Refer to figure 3.8 in the textbook and its accompanying table. The value of eta, on the other hand, determines the x-axis scale of the various graphs. If these graphs were drawn for eta equals 100 and for eta equals 1, as an example, the two graphs would look identical with only the figures on the x-axis differing. They will in the one case be 100 times those of the other case. Another important feature of the value of eta is that 63% of all components of that type will fail before eta time units and 37% after that point. In other words, the cumulative failure distribution capital F of eta equals 0.632 at that point, and the survival function R of eta equals 0.368 at that point. This is a consequence of the presence of the exponential function E in the relevant failure distributions. One would thus expect that 63% of all components will fail before or at this life, and 37% will survive up to this life. A last significant characteristic of eta is that the maximum component life will typically not exceed 2 times eta. This rule of thumb, maximum life, varies with the value of beta. In other words, we say it will typically not exceed 2 eta, but it varies. For lower values of beta, the maximum life is higher than 2 eta, while high values of beta corresponds to maximum lives lower than 2 eta. We secondly look at parameter estimation for the viable distribution. The shape of the hazard curve is the best indicator of which continuous distribution can be fitted to the data, as each distribution has a very specific signature hazard shape. Fortunately, most renewal failure data sets encountered in the maintenance environment can be fitted with one of the viable family of distributions. Consequently, although a case could also be made for the use of the exponential distribution, the gamma distribution, the normal distribution, and the log normal distribution in some cases, the Weibull should normally suffice, which makes our lives much easier. For the two-parameter Weibull distribution, the following set of equations can be derived using the maximum likelihood method. The first equation here is used to find the value of beta iteratively. The left-hand side of the equation is a constant, which can be simply calculated from the failure data. The value of beta must then be found such that it will make the value of the right-hand side of the equation equal to that of the left-hand side. The second equation is then used to simply calculate eta. Let us thirdly look at an example. An underground coal mine uses continuous miners to cut coal from the coal face. One of the expensive items to maintain on the machine is the cutting head gearbox, which transmits cutting power from the cutting motor to the cutting drum at the correct rotational speed. Failure data, that is the consecutive lives of the unit in production tons, is as follows. Putting the failure data into the TI column of an Excel spreadsheet, which can be downloaded from the MTech website at mtech.co.za, the following result is obtained. The first equation of equation 420 is split in two. The left hand of the equation is input into the cell to the right of the LH tag, left hand tag, while the right hand of the equation is input into the cell to the right of RH, the right hand tag. The second equation is input into the cell to the right of the eta tag. The process for solving for beta and eta is started by inputting any guessed value for beta in the cell to the right of the beta tag. Normally, 2 is a good start. In the table above, 1.5 was chosen. The spreadsheet then calculates 3 values for each failure data value. Firstly, TI to the beta. That's the second column of the table. Secondly, LIN TI. That's the third column of the table. And then the multiplication of those two columns, that is TI to the beta, LIN TI. That's the fourth column of the table. From the totals of these 3 columns, the values of LH and RH are calculated. These 2 values are not the same as the correct value of beta, and that of eta has not been found yet. By putting the cursor block on the cell to the right of RH and using the goalseek function of Excel, that's the tools menu in Excel 2003, the data what-if analysis in Excel 2007 and above, the value of RH can be set to the value of LH by changing the value of beta. The correct value of eta will also be automatically calculated in the process. The goalseek algorithm iteratively calculates the correct value of beta so that the right hand of the equation, that is RH in the spreadsheet, becomes equal to the constant left-hand LH in the spreadsheet. In this case, the value of beta equals 2.029 rounded to 2.03. This value changes the value of eta to 553,361.4389. Then rounded to 553,361 tons. Because beta is in the order of 2, the hazard curve would be a straight line increasing value. Also, the fact that it increases say that use-based maintenance may be an option for this gearbox, depending on the economy of the situation. See the video on replacement decision making. Another way of doing this analysis is by using MAnalyst, a computerized maintenance data analyzer available as download on the Amptech website, that is amptech.co.za. This then concludes this basic discussion of renewal theory. In the textbook on pages 94 and 95, the calculation of the expected life of a component under renewal is treated. This was left out of this discussion in the interest of limiting the scope to achieve clarity. I do hope that you find this information worthwhile and that you will be using it productively into the future. Thank you.